Welcome to the second part of Terraform for Java developers. I'm Julien Dubois. You can follow me on Twitter at Julien Dubois, and I am leading the Java Developer Advocacy Team at Microsoft. In this four-part series, we are introducing Terraform for Java developers, and you are currently in part two, where we will create a MySQL instance with Terraform. If you want to watch the other parts, they are available on our YouTube channel. So let's go back to where we left in part one. So we created a simple resource group with Terraform. And in this part, we're going to do something more complex. So this time we want to create our database, which is a MySQL database. If you have a look here at the application dash MySQL properties, you can see that Spring Boot can use the specific profile to connect to a production database, which is MySQL. And if we have a look here at the Docker Compose file, which is provided by Spring Picnic, you can see that Spring Picnic can use a MySQL version 5.7 with some parameters. So we are going to do the same configuration using Terraform. And for this, we're going to create more resources here. I can, of course, continue to type them here with auto-completion, but it's going to be easier with some examples. So let me go to the Terraform documentation. Here it is. Here is the documentation for the Azure ARM provider on Terraform. And I'm going to type my SQL database. And here it is. So here's the documentation. It's providing me some example code on how to create a MySQL database using Terraform. I'm going to copy paste this. And we're going to have a look at this example to better understand what Terraform does and how we can use it. So let me just paste this and let's have a look. So we have two resources which have been copy-pasted here. There is one of type MySQL server and another one of type MySQL database. That's specific to Azure. So that's the first thing that we need to consider here. When you use Terraform, your code depends on your cloud provider. If I was using another cloud, probably, well, I would have different resource types and very probably I would have different configurations, different attributes. All of this is specific to your cloud provider. So when you use Terraform, you need to have a good look at the documentation of your cloud provider because those attributes will depend on them. And of course, you need to input the right attributes depending on what your cloud provider supports, but also you need to use the good attributes depending on your specific needs. All of those resources are all called example. As it's a database and I've only got one, I can keep calling it example. But of course, if I had different databases, I would call them like database one and database two, and they would be of the same type. And I would have like two different resources with different names. One thing that needs to be noted here is the name here. So that's the name of my resource inside Azure. So in fact, here I've got two names. I've got here the name of my Terraform resource. That's inside Terraform. That's an easy to use name. And here I've got the name of my resource inside Azure. So that's a name which probably will be more complex. It should be unique, by the way, inside Azure. So I'm going to write something else. I'm going to use my username. So I'm pretty sure it's unique. This should be available. After that, I've got more configurations. So let's just have a look at those two ones here. As you can see, they are not pointing to a string, but they are using a variable. So let me just delete this so we can see auto-completion going on. So the location of the database is inside, so something of type, a resource of type Azure ARM resource group, which is named example, and I'm going to use its location. So this is pointing to this type of resource with this name and this attribute. So this is pointing to West Europe. So by doing this, I can link my resources between them. So I do not have to repeat those strings. So that's, of course, a lot more error-proof than typing everything. So I'm doing the same thing for the location and the resource group. And after that, I've got some very specific configuration for my database. So the login, let me just use the same login as the one they use here, so we are more consistent. So it's called Pet Clinic. I need to have a unique password. So it's probably not a good idea to have your password here. You can, well, with Azure, you've got many different ways to store your password. It should not be here in plain text, probably. And here, then, I've got some specific configuration for my database to know which attributes you need to use. Well, you need to have a look at the documentation. For example, the SKU, so that's the type of database we're using. I want to use like something cheaper, so I'm going to use V1. There is no tree, for example. The only way to know that is to have a look at the documentation. That's why there is quite a lot of work for you as a database creator if you want to have the right attributes here. I'm also going to delete all of those. By the way, in that example, some of those are not correct. So again, I recommend you to have a look at the documentation and also have a look at your specific needs. For example, here I'm keeping SSL because I want to have everything secured. You probably want the same, but of course, that's up to you. So that creates a MySQL server for me. And the next resource is a database. So that's specific to Azure. They separate the server from the database. And my database, I'm going to call it Pet Clinic. And keeps your resource group. 7M points to the one I've created before. And Carset is going to stay the same. So those two resources should create my database. So let me go back to the command line. I'm going to tell Terraform apply. And now let's discuss a little bit more about what's happening here. Because in the previous part, we just said we're going to apply and it's going to work, but we didn't look into the details. So as you can see, I'm just going to click yes so it goes faster. The first thing it did is refreshing its state. So we didn't talk about state yet, but what Terraform does, in fact, is that it's showing a state. There is a state of your cloud resources, which is stored into a local file. Let me just go back to the IDE here. In the Terraform repository, we've got two new files which have been created. We've got a state here, and we've got a log file here. So the log file here is to prevent other people to modify the state at the same time as you. That state can be local, but you can also store it remotely. Typically, you can store it into an Azure Blob storage, which is what you would probably do if you work as a team. So you've got a log file and you've got a state file. The state file is storing the current state of your infrastructure. So this one should be refreshed from Azure. So if we go here to the Azure portal, you remember we only had a resource group. So currently that's the only state it has got. But the state is different to the desired state. So the desired state is the one we have created here, which has a MySQL server. So what Terraform is doing is that it's doing a check between what is available in the cloud, the state that is currently has, and the state that you desire. And that's how it is calculating that it needs to change those resources. So it will create a database and it will create a server. And it only knows that because it can check between the desired state that you just described and the state that it currently has. And that's how it plans what it's going to do. And it said, I'm going to add those two resources. I'm not going to change anything. I'm not going to destroy anything. And as I said, yes, well, it's creating everything. So this will create my database. While it's creating it, let's go to the next resources that we need to create. That's also specific to Azure. So we are creating here a database, but in order to be able to access the database, we need to have a firewall that is opened. By default, those databases are secured, so there is a firewall and you cannot access them. So here I'm going to go back to my command line and create a firewall. Firewall, here it is. And I'm going to create a new firewall and we will have a look again at how states are being managed by Azure, because we're going to be able to change this one. So this firewall, I'm going to call it Azure. It's a firewall, a rule that will allow my application server, which we have not created yet, that's going to allow my application server to connect to my database. And for that, its IP address needs to be 0.0.0. So that's specific to Azure. Again, for this, you need to have a look at the documentation. And let's say that instead of doing this, I'm doing a mistake. I did this, for example, which is totally stupid, of course. And we're going to have a look at how Azure manages the state when you do an error. So let's have a look at our database. So it has been created. By the way, I can do Terraform state to have a look at the current state of my cloud. So you've got different commands here. So if I want to list my resources state list, we can see that we've got a resource group, a server, and a database. So that's, of course, correct. If I have a look in my cloud provider here in my Azure portal, if I refresh my resource group, I'm going to see my database, and inside I've got my server. Let me just click here to check the firewall. Type here firewall, connection security. My firewall is here, and currently we've got no rule, which is correct because I didn't do anything. And let's manage that firewall using Azure. So you remember I typed those IP addresses which are wrong, and I'm going to tell Terraform apply. It's going to check the current state of our resources. It's going to check my desired state, which is with the firewall, and it's going to tell me, okay, I need to add that firewall. And it's going to add one more resources, so what we have already done several times before. But again, this resource is not good because my IP addresses are wrong. So this time I'm going to want to be able to update one existing rule. So if I just have a look at the state again, now we've got a firewall rule here. That's good. And if I go to the Azure portal, let's go back here. And if I refresh this, let's just refresh the page. We've got our firewall rule here, which is wrong. So that's bad. So let me just update here to have it correct. So that's the firewall rules I wanted to have. Let's do again apply here. So this time, instead of creating a new resource, it's going to update an existing one. That works depending on the resource you are using. So sometimes you can destroy something when you do this, so you need to be careful. But in this case, it's going to update something. So as you can see, Terraform saw that the state has changed, and that is going to change the end IP address as well as the start IP address. It's going to change it from my wrong value to the correct value. So the plan is 0 to add, 1 to change, 0 to destroy. It's exactly what I want. I'm going to hit yes. It's going to update my firewall rule. And as soon as it's done, we can go back to our portal here. And instead of those rules, we're going to have the new rules applied here. So this rule is specific. So it's not a rule that is written here. It's written here. It's allow access to other services. It was no, now it's yes. So I can access my other services using Azure that way. So in that section, we have created something a little bit more complex. We have created a database with some firewall. We have seen how Terraform handles state and manage it from the state that you desire, which is in your file, and the state that is applied, which is in the cloud. And we saw that we could add and modify resources. Of course, we can destroy them. We will destroy them all at the end. In the next section of this video, we are going to talk about best practices. We have created here our resources by just copy-pasting sample code. Of course, they are not using best practices. So next chapter, we're going to improve our existing Terraform configuration to follow best practices and to have something which is better to use. Thank you.